This Chem 1A lecture video pertains to the nature and calculations involved in reactions in solution. Our learning objectives are twofold. We will look at how to apply stoichiometric ratios for determining the reactant or product amounts when dealing with an aqueous reaction, and also use that stoichiometry to interpret the results of a specific type of experiment called a titration. The problem with a homogeneous mixture, like a solution, is that you can't tell how much solute is in a solution by just looking at it. Often, we try to quantify the amount of solute within a sample, and we can do this using what's called quantitative analysis. Two types of quantitative analysis that apply to solutes in solution are titration and gravimetric analysis. To successfully perform a titration, we need to have a solution containing a solute that will react with the solute in our unknown solution. And ideally, when those two solutes react with each other, there is a visible change in properties so that we can know when all of the analyte has been consumed by the titrant, or the solution of known concentration. With a gravimetric analysis, we need a solute as well, but in this case, we want that solute to be able to precipitate out the solute in our analyte. Then we can collect the precipitate and by its mass determine how much of analyte must have been in our original solution of our unknown. Titrations are excellent examples of the limiting and excess problems. The way they're performed is our analyte is in a Erlenmeyer flask, and the analyte again is the solute of unknown concentration. And the titrant of known concentration is placed in a piece of glassware called a burette, which has graduations and a stopcock that controls delivery of the liquid. The graduations and the stopcock allow us to be able to carefully add the titrant to the analyte and measure the volume of titrant added. In this scenario, the analyte contains the solute as a limiting reactant, and so we want to add enough titrant to fully react with all of the analyte. This would give us the equivalence point of our titration. Now, often it is not possible to visualize exactly the moment when you've added enough titrant to fully consume the analyte. What you actually need to do is add a slight amount of excess titrant, and that will result in either a color change or some other easily measurable change in the properties of your solution. And that is what we call the end point. So when performing a titration, the end point is always going to be a little bit bigger than the equivalence point, but we try to minimize the difference between the two. Some titrations, the reactions between the titrant and the analyte are such that we can visualize this change or this excess of titrant without any added substance. However, many types of titrations, especially acid-base reaction titrations, involve a secondary substance that is sensitive to an excess in titrant, and this is called an indicator. If titrations are applications of the limiting and excess concept, that means we can apply our stoichiometry concept map. In this case, we are dealing not with the mass of reactants or products, but with their molarities, because we're dealing with solutions. So when we whittle away what we don't need from the concept map, we're left with these boxes. So the limiting reactant is our analyte, but we can't directly measure the amount of analyte. That's the whole point of our titration. What we are going to be able to measure is the amount of titrant. And that, by looking at its volume and concentration, will give us a mole value. So really we're using the, though our analyte is limiting, we're using the titrant as our limiting reactant for the calculation. So we need the molarity of titrant, so it is of known concentration, and we want to get to the moles of titrant, so what do we need there? We need the volume that comes out of our burette. And so by multiplying our molarity by our volume, we end up with the moles of titrant. Again, we need to have a known reaction between these two species, so we use the balanced equation and to find the molar ratio between titrant and analyte. And from that, we can get the moles of analyte. Now, this is an unknown solution, but we can easily measure its volume. So if we know the moles of analyte that was within that solution, we simply divide by the volume of analyte, and that will give us its molarity. Let's look at an example. This is an acid-base titration between the strong acid hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide, which gives us a lovely 1-to-1 stoichiometry to keep the math simple. So let's use our word problem sorting technique to figure out how to solve this problem. All right, the endpoint in a titration of a 50 milliliter sample of aqueous HCl was reached by addition of 35.23 mL of 0.25 molar sodium hydroxide titrant. Okay, so let's sort out our information. So we're given a volume of HCl, so 50 milliliters, and we're given a volume and a concentration of sodium hydroxide. So we have 35.23 mL and a concentration. So clearly, in this case, our sodium hydroxide is the titrant and our hydrochloric acid is our analyte. Since we know both the volume and concentration of our sodium hydroxide, we can use that to calculate out the moles of sodium hydroxide that were delivered in this titration. We then will look at the balanced stoichiometry between titrant and analyte being 1-to-1 and find the moles of analyte within that unknown solution. Last step, we do know the volume of our analyte solution, and so by taking the moles divided by the volume, making sure we are using liters, we can get the molarity of HCl. So setting this all out in math, we would simply take the volume of sodium hydroxide. So I'm going to just do a quick mental math, substituting or converting my milliliters into liters. So I have 0.03523 liters of sodium hydroxide times 0.250 molar, and that gives me 0.0088075 moles of our NaOH. Looking again at our next step, we're simply multiplying by 1. So that's simple math. That means in our analyte, there must have been, the same number of moles of HCl. Last step, we're going to take that number of moles and divide it by the volume. Again, doing that quick mental math to convert between liters and milliliters and keeping in all of our sig figs. And we come to the answer of 0.1675 molar. And checking with our significant figures, we have 4, 4, 3. So we're going to round to the third decimal. So 0.168 molar HCl was the concentration of that unknown hydrochloric acid solution. You will also encounter stoichiometry problems using solutions that aren't necessarily couched in terms of a titration, but we can still apply the same problem-solving techniques and concepts. I encourage you, as you're watching this portion of the video, to pause before I give you the real solution to see if you can predict what we're going to do and try to solve the problem on your own, and then only proceed the video when you think you're stuck. Okay, so in this problem, instead of asking for a final molarity, it starts with what volume in liters? So it's termed very differently from a titration question. Anywho, what volume of 0.150 molar potassium chloride solution will completely react with a 0.15 liters of a 0.175 molar lead to nitrate solution according to the following balanced chemical equation? So we're given a balanced chemical equation. We know we need that because it's a stoichiometry problem. We're dealing with two different types of substances, the potassium chloride and the lead nitrate. We're also given both the concentration in molarity and the volume in liters of one of the participants in the reactions. We're given, finally, the molarity of the other participant in the reaction and asked to find its volume. So you can see these are the same kinds of variables that we have with a titration, just with a different one of the variables being our unknown. So in this case, the volume. So what's our strategy going to be? Well, with any problem involving amounts of different substances in a reaction, we know it's a stoichiometry problem, and that tells us we need to find moles. And specifically, what moles can we find with the given information? We can find the moles of lead to nitrate because we have both its molarity and its volume. What next? Well, once we know the moles of one player in the reaction, we can find the moles of the other player. So the question is asking something about potassium chloride. So we're going to use the molar ratio between lead to nitrate and potassium chloride to find the moles of potassium chloride. Next, if we have the moles, we also have the molarity in the problem. So we're going to take the moles, dividing that by molarity to give us liters. Because remember that molarity is simply moles over liters. So if we take moles and divide that by moles over liters, moles is canceling and liters is coming on top as a double reciprocal. So again, maybe you want to stop here. We've got the strategy. See if you can lay out your math and come to the answer to the problem. Because now I'm about to reveal the math. Note that you can do this problem all in one straight shot by watching your ratios and making sure that you're always placing your units to be canceled. So starting out with the two things that we do know, the volume of the lead to nitrate solution and its molarity, moles over liters, you can get the liters canceled, leaving you with moles of lead to nitrate. We then use our stoichiometry to cancel out lead nitrate and leave us with potassium chloride. Finally, we're dividing by the molarity of potassium chloride. So that's the same as multiplying by the reciprocal of molarity, so liters over moles. And you come to the final answer with the correct number of sig figs of 0.350 liters of potassium chloride. Hopefully this video has helped you understand how you can apply stoichiometry to problems involving materials in solution.